You're now listening to an official Oh So City mix.
Oh, Oh So City. Well, good afternoon, everybody. Oh, I have to regulate my voice. Good afternoon. My name is Gigantse Pele. I am the Senior Program Manager at Accountability International. We welcome you to the session this afternoon. Thank you very much for making time. So our theme is challenging criminalization of key populations. HIV and AIDS, community responses in alignment with the Sustainable Development Goals or SDGs. And I would like to just talk a little bit about challenging criminalization, which is a project that Accountability International has been working on since 2017 under different themes. And for this year, we are looking at bodily autonomy. We are looking at LGBTI rights, as well as the role of law enforcement in terms of criminalization. You will hear the different strategies from my panelists, who I will introduce shortly. So Accountability International, it's an international hybrid organization. I work remotely from Botswana. My colleague Sheriff Motope works remotely from Lesotho. We are registered as an NPO in South Africa and as a foundation in Sweden. So our work is around research and by using scorecards as a means of, you know, drawing evidence as well as creating evidence as well as in line with advocacy. So without taking much time, I'm going to briefly, if you look at those who have the agenda, if you look at the agenda, our board member, Professor Sheila Crow, was supposed to be here, but she's bereaved, so I have taken over that role. She has just lost her mom, so she couldn't make it to Harare at all. So I will introduce my speakers. I will start with Thato Tiane. Thato is from Lesotho. Thato is an advocacy officer and project coordinator at the People's Metrics Association in Lesotho. And then we have Koli Butelesi. She's the executive director of Sisonke, South Africa. It's a sex worker-led organization. And then we have Queen Bee. Queen Bee is a human rights researcher and campaigner at the Trans and Intersex Rising Zimbabwe. So welcome my panel. We will start right away with the questions. So we basically have three questions for this session, and then I'll be asking the first question, starting with you, Thato. How is the work that you are doing addressing, combating HIV in response to the Sustainable Development Goals? Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you've had a good day so far, and thank you for being here with us today. So I will be speaking on the context of Lesotho and the work that we're doing as I represent the People's Matrix as an LGBTI organization. And we work in coalition very closely with other KP community organizations such as the sex worker-led organizations as well as ex-inmates and ex-inmates organizations. So I'll be speaking to the work that we collectively do together and also some in parts, right? So our approach to the HIV response, really, we offer to our community members. This is the community of LGBTI members, sex workers, you know, inmates and ex-inmates. We offer biomedical interventions, so the standard art treatment, linkages to facilities and treatment. However, the way that we approach it, because understanding that the key populations community is a specialized community, we tailor make our services, even those biomedical services, specifically for our community's needs. So we see our communities as a person first, and therefore we tailor those services to them, looking at their context and making sure that the services are holistic. So this looks like one, methods of down to our commodities. Our commodities are diverse and responsive to our community members. So it's not just includes male condoms, but femdoms as well, include finger doms as well, because we have a vast array and diverse communities, right? It looks like our methodology is different, where for the general population, facilities and clinical facilities should be sufficient, but we take it to a step further for even at-home deliveries of services, prep in-house prep where community members can come and find access to communities. And then further than that, we bring a holistic package along with the art services that we bring, whether that looks like bringing along psychosocial support when we're delivering services, whether it looks like linking them to service gender affirming healthcare services, because when you approach a person, you know, as an individual and understand their needs, when we come to, you know, the HIV response and prevention and treatment, we want to, you know, address everything around their context around the environment. These are issues about their mental well-being. These are issues about their livelihood, right? If we're talking about issues of adherence. So we bring that kind of comprehensive, holistic package when we bring the services to our community members. So those are the ways in which we have specialized them. And I think in that ways, we're starting to, you know, respond to SDG 10 that looks at reducing inequalities, because once we start taking into consideration issues that some people live remotely, some people maybe are still facing stigma, so they can't access services. Bringing services to the at their home, we're able to start reducing that. But even more, I think we have an element of advocacy that is tied in, but I think I'll speak to that later on as a strategy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Tato. I think it's quite a comprehensive and detailed services that you provide, particularly looking into reduced inequalities as one of the goals for the SDGs. Colleague, the same question goes to you, and I'll repeat it. How is the work that you are doing addressing HIV in response to SDGs?
Good afternoon. thank you so much. Good afternoon. This is Koli speaking. I am the national the director of Fusisong and the founding member. I won't dwell too much on the introduction because it has been done. I think I'm here to speak, and I speak a lot. So let me just start right now. Okay, so as an organization, when it was founded back in 2003, we started as a movement. We registered in 2017 so that we can be able to achieve the work of the movement. We have not changed. But what I think it's important for me to highlight in this panel is that we as a movement, we're not a service delivery. Our work, we form partnership with organizations that provide service delivery to sex workers. So we become the middle person of the people that want to reach to sex workers. We mainly do the advocacy work. I think around healthy issues are the main challenge, because as you know, that sex work is criminalized in South Africa and in other parts of Africa. We also do the advocacy, I think, around the decriminalization of adult consenting sex work, because we believe that in order for us to be able to achieve the 2030 HIV, you know, and the 95-95 goals, it is important that sex work is recognized as work, but also to make sure that people do understand that the sex work, the decrim is not about sex work, because people are engaging in this kind of sexual intercourse. But the decrim is about rights of sex workers around health issues and also the human rights, because health is human rights and you can't separate the two. So we try our best to follow the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, which in all of the Sustainable Development Goals, goal 3, 5, 10, 16, and 17, those are main goals that speaks to sex work issues. So we then build a partnership with organizations, but also we form part of the civil society in South Africa. It is important that also sex workers and key populations are recognized in that kind of a space, so that they can be able to inform, you know, all the policies around HIV, policies around human rights, because if they're not, they're not represented. And then we cannot let people to speak about sex workers on behalf of sex workers while sex workers are present. As sex workers are the people that actually operating, they know business better. It is important that in all decision making, in all issues that are health related, and sex workers are human being at the end of the day. So the work that we do is around informing all policies within civil society. We also form part of CCM. We also form part of the oversight committee. You know, when you have key populations in those platforms, making sure that they oversee the smooth running of the fundings that come into the country, the implementation of the initiatives, that makes a greater impact, I think, in terms of fighting the and keeping the HIV in the country. So we also participate on the African key population expert groups, which is the regional group that also brings the key populations representatives in a different aspect to make sure that we also inform, but also look into what are the gaps and how best those gaps can be addressed. So yeah, I don't know if I've answered you correctly, because yeah, as I said earlier on, that we don't do service provision, but our role is to make sure that we strengthen partnership with partners that render services to sex workers so that we can do a referral. So we become the middle person, but we're making sure that in all structures, in all policies, in all processes, that the sex workers are there and well represented by the sex workers themselves. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kweli, for that comprehensive response. I will go to Queen Bee. How does the work that you are doing address combating HIV in response to the Sustainable Development Goals?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I think for us from trans and intersex community, I'm also coming from Trans and Intersex Coalition of Zimbabwe, where we also, as trans, we have three organizations in Zimbabwe which are working with trans community. We have Transbed Trust, which is in Harare when it comes to HIV, where we are working with Global Fund. We have TREATS, which is in Blawayo, and we have TIERS, which is working in also in Manicaland. This is under Global Fund, with the collaboration with the National AIDS Council and the Minister of Health. So as TIERS, as trans community, what have we done so far to also align our community members to get the services they want? We don't give services to the community. What we do is to link them through, and we do sensitization with other health service provision. We work with SESHA, which is mainly targeting sex workers. We also believe that we have, in our community, there are sex workers in trans community who are also needing the services that SESHA can provide, PrEP and other commodities. We also work with our local clinics. Here in Araro, we work with Wilkins, where we also have a GB clinic, where we also do sort of like collaboration when we work with the communities. Our work, we don't only end on HIV. We also look at things that can lead to HIV, which are gender-based violence, IPV, where intimate partners violence, and where also where we see this one, I can't say it's a real good name to say it, but let me just say it, corrective rape, where people call it a corrective rape. When you see trans men and then men perceives to say that they don't know what a real man is, we'll show them. Where a group of a gang rape a trans man to just satisfy themselves and say that we want to do a corrective rape. These are some of the issues that are happening. We have cultural norms which are in our African heritage, where we push a certain person to be married or look for a wife or husband for them. So these things also come and contribute into HIV, where a person is now forced to be sleeping with somebody they do not really want, because it's in a cultural. So in Zimbabwe, we have diversity of cultures, we have different people, we have different languages. So each province, they have their own laws. There are areas that we are as community are not able to enter, to talk about the LGBTI community, even to talk about the transgender, even the intersex child. We also have issues with a lot of other stakeholders who are also closing the doors as gatekeepers. But we as Trans Coalition and also as TIERS, we fight those spaces by coming into spaces and also giving them information and education based on what we have. So our collaboration doesn't end in only those in those areas. With the help of the National AIDS Council, we are able to get into some provinces that are allowing us to get there. And you know, in our cultural norms, it's only known that if you are an LGBTIQ, it's a Western thing. It's not a Zimbabwean thing, or it's not an African thing. But unfortunately, it's different, because people are born in different ways, in a dynamic way. That's what I want to say. Whenever we look at the communities, let's look at them as human beings. Besides looking at a person that this is a sex worker, believe that this person is a human being. Those are some of the things that we go into the communities, engage. We work in our five thematic areas, which are health, where we look at all related diseases that a person can be stigmatized or discriminated to. We look at religion and culture. Despite you are a sex worker, it doesn't mean that you don't want God. Despite you are an LGBTIQ, it doesn't stop you from calling God or praying to God. These are some of the dynamic things that also affect the community and lead them astray. So these are some of the things where we work and try to get relationship to those who are willing to get us into their spaces. So as tiers, we have helped to do survey on LEAR, legal environmental studies. How does an LGBT person or a trans person specifically living in Harare, what are the conditions? Are they able to walk? Is there any harassment? Is there issues of HIV? Because when it comes to trans women, the negotiation when it comes to sex workers, trans women who are in sex work, negotiation is very difficult. Because one, the person will expose you or that person will threaten you. So you have to. At the end of the day, there's no compromising of using condoms. There's no lubricant. There's no issues of like, how much are you going to be paid? It's maybe you're going to be forced or harassed so that people will be in fear. So these are some of the things that we do as a, in our country. We work in collaboration. As I told you that we have a coalition. This coalition also has a coalition of intersex organizations which are in, because they are also facing the same stigma. And when it comes to health, we are talking about gender affirming is not part of it. And we are trying to push on SRHR so that gender affirming is part of the sexual reproductive health. Why can't we also promote the issues of gender affirming? Because when we talk about gender affirming, it's not looking at trans people or intersex people. It's also looking at hetero people, the larger communities. Because there are other people who might say, I'm not feeling well and comfortable of what I look like, or I need this to, you know, those are some of the things that we need to talk about. But when we talk about gender affirming, people only think that these are the people who want homosexuals, who want to just change. But it's only about the body autonomy, as you said it, the politics of the body. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Queen B, for that. I am going to ask you a follow-up question, because I think the issue of, you know, you spoke about harmful cultural practices. So in terms of your thematic areas, I would just really like you to briefly share with us in terms of your collaborations, how do you, are you working with traditional leaders to, you know, bring forth the message that you've been speaking about of non-discrimination, as well as attaining reduction of HIV infections in alignment with the achievement of the sustainable development goals. So I'd really like you to just briefly touch on that.
Yeah, it's on now. So, sorry, I'm having difficulty with this mic. We do work with religion leaders who are willing. That's why I said who are willing. We have those stakeholders who are willing to help us. And when we go to the religion leaders, we are not demanding or something. We're just asking for a creative space or that part where you say that let's be on the same path. Because what we believe as community, we believe that if we go to church, it's a hospital. It should be a hospital for anybody who has a lot of burden they have in their mind. It's not about how am I, because I am a trans person, I'm here sitting here, and I'm going to God telling him as what I am, not hiding who I am. But if I pretend to be John, when I know I'm not John, that becomes a problem to God. But I come as who I am. So these are some of the sentiments that we also come into the play. Because I grew up in a family that is a religion, so I understand my church religion, but there are things that I can't run away from because that's who I am. So we have that platform where we do those programs, where we engage them. The cultural leaders, the chiefs and all, we have learned one thing, because I told you that Zimbabwe has a diversity of cultures. In other areas, they know us with different words. In other areas, they know us as stubborn. Some areas they know as Ngochan, because to them they understand those words. Some of others they say a man who looks like a woman. So it's a lot of words that are carried on. So when we get to the chiefs, it's more of we tell them the description of the person. Who is this person? How does this look like? And then they start to now to look at their own cultural history of the village. We used to have this person. But what we did, because these are some of the things that are coming from the chiefs, they tell you, no, we used to have Sam. Sam was not able to talk to a girl, to tell a girl that I love you, was so shy and wah, wah, wah. Then we found a wife for Sam. Maybe this wife had already one child. She'd be brought to Sam by force. And when they see that there's no pregnancy happening in this house, in Zimbabwe, we call it Ngoma Iskurira. And that means that the drum is not being beaten. So it already, they will look for a little brother to come into play. So already we now see the gaps. The issue is the language, how to say it. And then the issue is like our culture are not written down. They change because it's a construction of different generations that comes after in another. So in our work, it's more of sensitization. We give them information. It's up to them to say, okay, we would allow you to come into our space to talk to this. But the main challenge that sometimes that we get is your content has to be seen. They have to remove certain issues. And I remember when we were also in solidarity with the youth, when we were talking about underage, when we were talking about 18 years should be able to go to access health service, 14 years and 16 years. When we talked about, when we said sexual reproductive health rights, the rights issue was like, remove it, sexual, remove it, let it be silent. So whenever you're getting into those rural areas, it's almost like you remove other certain words that might trigger a lot of emotion, or you wouldn't get to the communities. So what we have discovered, there's a gap of information that is there.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Queen Bee, for highlighting that. And I think you also raised a very important aspect of, you know, the existence of language and how language also points to that, LGBTI persons have always been there, and it's not really necessarily, and it's not truly and a Western agenda, as, you know, some African leaders will say. So I'll come back to you, Thato, and ask you in terms of the work that you are doing at the People's Metrics Association in Lesotho, what are some of the key strategies that you are undertaking or using in terms of, you know, reducing, or like you said, there are many linkages that you have undertaken in terms of the work that you're doing. I would really like you to be brief because we are left with only about 20 minutes. Yeah.
Thank you for that. For the purposes of being brief, I think I'll speak to not just the context of Matrix and Lesotho, but because of we are key populations communities, we do not walk alone, right? We walk with our siblings in the region because our struggles are very much the same. So I think even piggyback on what Queen Bee has said is that there's the gap of information. We talked around the issue of language, right? And our strategy is to write ourselves into the stories, into the policies, to write our own narratives, right? Mm-hmm. And that is also by doing the research. Queen Bee talked a lot about the importance of research and knowledge building. So key to our advocacy and speaking for ourselves and writing ourselves, you know, in the story, what is a very key strategy is what we call in the KP language, community-led monitoring, CLM. And it is very important for community sex workers, you know, LGBTI ex inmates, to say for themselves, this is what the experiences of our community members are at health facilities, with the projects being implemented in our communities. This is how we feel about them, and this is how they are responding immediately to our challenges, right? Still looking in the HIV response, which of course we know is so much broader. It's issues around SRHR, it's issues around bodily autonomy, it's issues around criminalization and legislature, right? So simply taking the community voice to say, communities are assessing the facilities that they use on particular themes of, are they accessible? Are the services accessible, affordable? You know, are the facility service people accountable to the community and what we say is happening? And being in a relationship where communities are engaging with, you know, the facilities and healthcare workers, you're starting a process of accountability and where we're able to fix things together. And then we take that evidence, which is the community's voice, and we go to the policymakers and we're saying, hey, this is what the KP community is saying. In our national policies, include diverse commodities, include a package, a holistic package of service delivery, right? Then we take that and we also go to our ministries of law and we're saying, look, the law that says people with a positive HIV status must have a higher sentencing than other people, that is unconstitutional, that is discriminatory, right? This is where we start tackling the issues of maybe prostitution is what is legalized and criminalized, but where are the provisions for sex work? And, you know, we start interrogating those things because the evidence is there. Sex workers exist, services, you know, there's a community. So to alleviate, we know how criminalization leads to higher rates of infections and violence, right? So taking the community's voice to do that advocacy on all of those levels, even back to the community, the grassroots, where we're saying to the religious leaders, there's a scourge of GBV, IPV in your communities and our churches, right? It's leading to high rates of infections and other, you know, ills. What are you doing about it, right? Bring the communities back into the churches, accept the communities into the, you know, community gatherings and beatles, and let them have their say and their voice so we can be able to tackle those things. So I really do believe empowering the community and their voice and documenting it and taking that voice and, you know, putting that evidence on different platforms is a strategy for us. Really, it's about quality improvement and assurance, but at all levels, not just health, but, you know, the legislature framework, societal services as well. So really, it's the documenting of the community and using that as advocacy first and foremost.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you so much, Tato. Koli, what are some of the strategies that you are using at Sisonke?
Okay. So thank you so much. There's two things that I think I forgot to mention earlier on around addressing the HIV response, that as we are part of the civil society, 18 sectors in South Africa, which is best practice. I wish other countries can copy that, making sure that you include and involve the grassroots communities in all those structures so that they can inform the advocacy strategies that we need to do in order for us to keep the HIV. So in South Africa, South Africa has actually developed the comprehensive HIV strategy, which is for sex work specific. There's a country NSP and then the sex work NSP. That is good practice because then that speaks to the key communities specific, because the issues of key communities, especially sex workers and gay, lesbians, trans women, it is not the same as the general community. So therefore, it is important that we take note of that and making sure that in all and any initiatives that I think we bring in our countries in making sure that we keep HIV and supporting our key communities, those are things that I think we need to make use of. So South Africa has developed that comprehensive HIV plan that is sex work specific, which is a good thing. We also do sensitization training with health and also legal services. It is not just e-sensitization, but I think it's educational empowerment on information, because we live with people that are older than us, that they were not familiar or not knowing anything about the LGBTQI plus, for an example, the trans women, you know, because back those days, we're living in the colonial, I think, history background, which it was marginalizing and, you know, shutting people down in terms of speaking out on and be comfortable of who they are. So then the other thing that we do, around reinforcing the agenda of key communities. We have worked, we currently also working with the traditional healers, and we were invited into a workshop, which I believe that it's a start of the strengthening of partnership in South Africa. And it was quite exciting to receive such an invitation from South African AIDS National Council, a key population, a technical advisor person. And then we work with also the faith-based organization, Cinerella, around the educational empowerment, hosting dialogues, because the role that they bring with it into us, which we are so privileged, is to educate communities out there that sex workers are human beings before they become sex workers. I think if we can put that in our mindset, we'll be able to realize that we have been hurting too many people on the ground because of calling them names, as my colleague had actually indicated. You know, some of the calling names that stigmatize our communities, which then makes them not to be able to come and access the services because they fear of the stigma and discrimination. So those are some of the key strategies that we do, but you're also strengthening partnership out of the civil society, because there are a lot of organizations that are funded by PEPFAR, by Love Alliance, you know, by AIDS Funds, by, you know, too many donors, by PEPFAR, that they do work around keeping the HIV. So we're definitely making sure that they try to keep in partnership with them, in order to make sure that we do bring the issues concerning the key population on the ground, and also to strategize on how best can we address that. I was just now recently attending, actually maybe 20 minutes ago, I was attending a session of young sex workers, issues that they brought to my attention. I was quite impressed, but also shocked to see that some of the prevention measures that are not present in some of the countries, which we need to have those varieties of prevention so that people can be able to choose. If the injectable prep works for me, I need to go for that. You know, if the injectable art works for me, I need to go for that. If I decide to take a femidome, or if I decide to take a ring, you know, the prep ring to prevent the HIV, those prevention measures, I think, should be available in our countries. And also donors should also focus in making sure that they fund those kind of a measurable prevention, so that we can be able to keep the HIV. Because for me, I feel that reaching 2030 goals under the criminalization system, we're just wasting time. I feel like we're investing into nothing, and it's a waste of resources. We need to recognize the importance of decriminalization so that people can be able to access those services and reach out to us, because there are people that are still in the closet because of being marginalized and also recognized as criminals. So therefore, that it's actually a barrier. The criminalization itself, it is a big barrier in everything that we are trying to do. You see how many people are in this conference? There's been more conference than this. We've been talking about the same thing. So I think it's high time that, you know, we do take action, and also make sure that our government come on board and recognize us that we are human beings. The morality are last thing to look into. I think we should prioritize the human rights, so that we can be able to be on the same page, and also be in the free world where communities are able to access the services, because there's some things that I think we cannot change. People are born like that. Sex workers is work. Sex workers work is business. You know, there's an issue of unemployment rate. Those are things that we don't look into, but we're quick at judging our communities. So yeah, decriminalization, I think, is the only way to go in order for us to be able to achieve the HIV pandemic in 2030. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Koli. I'm going to... Awesome. So I'm going to give the... Because we have 10 minutes now. So Queen Bee, I'm going to give you a minute to give two recommendations in terms of, you know, going forward, as well as for you, Koli, and as well as for you, Tato, and then we'll open for questions or comments.
So the other one is, just as been mentioned, decriminalization, as well as all...
So sorry, we have only 5 minutes, so we have to round up quite quickly. I'm advised that we have 5 minutes. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so I was saying the first one has been mentioned. I'm just also alluding to the same thing. There's need to be equality, inclusion. This is what we want as communities.
Thank you. Yes, please.
Definitely the decriminalization, but also I think we need to have a thorough advocacy at a global level, regional and at a national level. We must engage with relevant gatekeepers, but also making sure that the key communities are inclusive and included, involved in all the discussions around the prevention or anything related to KPs or anything related to HIV, but let it be a bottom-up approach, not just on in this high level, the grass communities don't have much to say, but also, yeah, I've added the decriminalization, which is my priority. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yes, Tata?
Mine is quick. I'm offering two tools. One is a community-led monitoring tool that is in 14 African countries, including Southern Africa, including Uganda, Kenya, and Nigeria as well. It's called Mabox, which is a community survey tool. You can find it at www.mabox.co.bw. Get in there. It's easy. It's user-friendly. It's for the LGBTI community, sex workers, people living with HIV, and ex-inmates and inmates are there as well. And then a second one that I would like to offer is, in your advocacy, there is a document called the 8 March Principles, which was principles offered by the International Commission of Jurists, which is a set of principles around criminalization and the conduct when it comes to issues around sex, homelessness, HIV, and whatnot. That is a very powerful tool to use in your advocacy, especially when it comes to legislative work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I am going to open for questions and comments, if any.
Thank you. So just to quickly introduce myself, my name is Zinke and I am from Sisonke National Movement. I think in terms of strategies now, I think we also need to look at educating young people. So how can we work with departments of education in their curriculum to also include correct information on key populations? Because we need to educate our children from that young age so that by the time that they enter into the world as adults, then they are properly sensitized. So I think those are other key stakeholders and government departments that we need to bring in. Thank you.
Thank you, Zinkler, for that. I think it's an excellent approach in terms of, you know, starting from earlier to build into the future. Any questions, contributions? Additions? All right, so in summary, thank you everybody for attending the session, and thank you to our panelists for such a wonderful work. And you can follow us as Accountability International on social media. On Twitter, we are at Account for All. And you can also go to our website, www.accountability.international. And so we come to exactly 10 to 4. Tato, I think you wanted to say something.
I think in closing, just to the lady from Sisonke, there's been a trend that we've seen that while we do the advocacy for comprehensive sexuality education, the issue is what the people have to implement it. So the teachers, right? And a lot of schools in rural areas tend to be like religion-based schools, right? So I remember a couple of young adolescent girls and young women said, it would be really great if I want to be a teacher. So when I go to the National Training Center, Teachers Training College, I'm hoping they will be teaching us on CSE. So this is even saying we can even take the advocacy further, that at nursing training college, right, or institutions that train educators and, you know, practitioners, that work about gender affirming healthcare services is being included in their curriculum. The work of CSE, you know, training teachers